Olympic athlete, and that's just really an insane thing to say. It's still hard to believe that just 5 years after leaving Mayors, I ended up representing the USA in Rio. And I know there's some Mayors students here and other young athletes from other schools, and I just want you to know that when I was in your shoes and walking through these halls, I had no idea that I had the slimmest chance of becoming an Olympian. Growing up, I played some soccer, and I took jazz and ballet and tap classes. And I always loved really being active and using my body and working hard and sweating. I loved all that kind of stuff. And anyone who knows me will tell you I'm a very competitive person. But for some reason, I typically just skirted away from athletic competition. And looking back, I think I was just really scared of losing, which is what I thought I equaled that to failure. So I often opted out of anything where there's a clear definition of success and failure. I was even too afraid to try out for club soccer team in middle school. Just played in a regular team soccer team. I was never interested in competitive dance, just dance performances. And then my freshman fall year, so I went out for the cross country team, just so I could stay in shape for soccer from the spring. But springtime came around and soccer tryouts came around, and Yerkes is has really competitive soccer teams. And so I got intimidated by that, and I was too nervous to even try out for the team. So I just decided, you know what? I had fun in cross country, and I had a lot of good connections with the girls there, and track is a no-cut sport, so maybe I'll just stick with that. Can't go there, can't get cut. But I never dreamed of being an Olympic athlete. I didn't even start running until my freshman year of high school, and I didn't decide to run in college until I was a senior in high school. Not until that fall of my senior year of high school did I start thinking, maybe I should take a scholarship and run in college. During that time, I was just trying to figure out what I wanted to do when I grew up, and honestly, I'm still trying to figure that out. And in the meantime, I was just trying to find activities that made me happy and that I was good at. And since I'm really competitive, usually those two things went together, because if I was bad at it, I probably wasn't having very much fun. So things that I was good at and I enjoyed doing. And I like other student athletes at Mayors to know that I didn't have a master plan for this life. I didn't have the next 5 years after Mayors mapped out with my dad and my other coaches and my road to Rio mapped out. It wasn't even until my senior year of college at FSU that I finally thought, maybe I could be an Olympian. That thought started to cross my head, or cross my brain, that maybe I could be an Olympian. Maybe I should set that goal and start working towards that. And that wasn't until, like a year ago, basically. When I was in high school, the goal were things like, I want a PR this weekend at the Forest Park cross country meet. And then the goal was, I'm going to qualify for state in the mile. And then the goal was, I'm going to become a series state champion. That would be awesome. And then it wasn't until eventually, many years later, the goal was, I'm going to be an NCAA champion. And then, eventually after that, I'm going to be an Olympian. But along the way, I set tangible and reasonable goals for myself. And then I set up a plan with my coach, oftentimes my dad, being a partner, to achieve those goals along the way until I got to the bigger goals. My parents never pressured me into becoming a runner, even though they were runners themselves. They never pressured me into becoming a runner or a dancer or a soccer player or a scientist or a lawyer. They just let me explore the world and find something I was good at and that brought me joy. And along the way, I just slowly improved. I wasn't winning state titles as a freshman, and they weren't pressuring me to do that either. And whenever I improved, whenever I met a goal, I kept looking for the next step and the next challenge in the journey. And this really allowed me to have a natural progression with goal setting along the way. And I really see goal setting as I'm not doing my slideshow. Sorry about that. This is me and Chris. This is the right is my dad and Peyton Chaney and I. Peyton and I, my senior year, track. I won the 1600 meters and she won the 1300 meters, and she plays in three events. She won two and the second one, so between the three of us, we were a third place team. We got the podium, just two athletes, so that was like the best senior year we had on the season. And then we love it, just a picture. So yeah, this is at NCAA my senior year when I won the steeplechase. So I tried to never put a limit on myself on where I would stop improving. And because of that, you know, I got a lot further than I ever thought I would. And it definitely was really scary at first to say those goals. The first time I ever said the words, I want to be an NCAA champion. I was sitting around the dinner table with my parents around Christmas time. It was my senior year of college, and we were all setting goals for the new year. And I said that goal out loud, and it's really scary, but it makes you accountable for your goals and helps you stick to them when the going gets tough. Which brings me to the second thing I want to talk about, which is, the second thing I want to talk about is grit and tenacity. So you're setting these goals, and then what are you going to do along the way to achieve the goal? And in my story as well as pretty much any other athlete's story that I know of, there's high points and there's low points, and there's challenges and there's struggles, and times when things weren't going as smoothly as they would have hoped. And this might seem obvious at first, but oftentimes when you make it through a challenging time, the struggle part is just kind of forgotten about and swept under the rug, and all you can talk about is the glory of the success and how great it turned out in the end. And especially now with social media being what it is, you know, everyone can just show off the good stuff and leave out the not so pretty details. And I'm honestly guilty of the same thing. There's always struggle and there's always challenges though. And I really think that these moments define us just as much as the successful ones do. So I love to tell the story about my teammate, Shalane. This one was when we first met. It was my senior year of high school, and I had qualified for nationals cross country, and it was in California, and so I was out there for that, and Shalane was one of the professional sled runners who were there to kind of get us excited about racing. So she had already made three Olympic teams by that point, and you know, she's pretty famous, so I just got my picture with her because, you know, she's really cool. And now she's my teammate, and I train her every day, and I call her a close friend, and I call her mom. She's like the mom of our team, and she's a really good friend of mine. And the story about Shalane is from the 2008 Olympic Games, which was in Beijing. And she had qualified in the 10,000 meter race, but a few days before she was supposed to compete, she got really, really, really sick, and she lost a lot of fluid. She couldn't keep anything down. She lost weight. She could barely get out of bed, and she couldn't run for the few days leading up to the race. It was not a good situation. And her coach even suggested that maybe she should pull out and not race because, you know, it was for fear of embarrassing herself on the world stage. Maybe you should just pull out and not do it. But besides this fear, that's not who Shalane is. So she got on the starting line and fought her way through it, and incredibly enough, she ended up winning a bronze medal that day. So I'm really glad she got on the line. Most people don't even know though that she was sick beforehand because that part's just kind of left out of the story. And, you know, the great part of the story is really promoted. But I love to tell that part because I think it's just a perfect example of the grit and tenacity that you have in order to achieve your goals. You know, she trained for so many years to get to that point, and there was absolutely nothing that was going to stand in the way of her achieving the goal of racing that day and just putting her best off on the line. And you know, my story also has some peaks and valleys, and I had plenty of learning experiences along the way. And things didn't exactly go as I thought they were going to, as I hoped they would. And so there's a few of those points where I graduated high school without ever having achieved Missouri State Cross Country Champion. And that was a goal of mine that I never achieved. I was third my junior year, and then my senior year going into the cross country state meet, I was favored to win. By pretty heavily, but when the day came, I totally crumbled under the pressure. I panicked. The race wasn't going how I wanted it to, and I panicked about it, and I slid back and I finished third for a second year in a row, and I was really bummed about that, but I used that to my advantage in that spring. I was even more motivated and even stronger for track season, so then that was the spring where, you know, Peyton and I finished third as a team, and I was the state champion in 1600 and 32 that spring. A few years later, I finished runner-up in the NCAA steeplechase to the now two-time Olympian and 2016 bronze medalist Emma Coburn. And I was just a sophomore. I was running up to her, and so she graduated that year, and pretty much assumed that I would be the national champion the next year, my junior year, because she was going to be gone.